surgery, and I'll be speaking partly on lateral sinus approach. So we would be jumping from physics to biology and from biology to physics during this seminar. So the following would be the agenda for today's presentation. We will begin with discussing a brief history of piezo surgery and the physics behind the piezo surgery. Then we will jump on to the maxillary sinus, the brief anatomy of the maxillary sinus, and then the procedure per se, how we can do direct sinus lift using piezo surgery, what tips and in what order to be used, and the advantages of piezo surgery over other alternatives of doing direct sinus lift. And in the end, I will have a brief conclusion where I could sum up all the above said things. Okay. So we know the very reputed Curie family. So piezo surgery was discovered before X-rays by the two brothers Jacques and Pierre Curie. And it was the Pierre Curie and his wife Madame Curie later on who discovered X-ray in 1904. So before they received the Nobel Prize for X-rays, the Jacques and the Pierre Curie received Nobel Prize for piezo surgery. So in fact, the science of piezo surgery is dated way before the X-rays, but it has not been developed so much until recently as compared to the X-rays. So what is piezoelectricity? It's basically a charge that is accumulated in crystals. So if we apply some stress or strain onto the crystal, which leads to a deformation of the crystal, which is noted in certain ceramics, they respond to this mechanical stress in the form of an electricity generation. As you can see on the right side of the screen, as the crystal is squeezed, there is a charge generated in the voltmeter. Okay. The best part of this is that it is a reversible phenomena in two ways. One, once the force or the compression or the tension force is released, the charges are nullified to zero. And secondly, it can work in two dimensions. So applying force on the crystal can lead to electricity generation, and applying electricity onto crystals can lead to force generation. Okay. So all the crystalline solids, we know that they have an electric dipole. They have a positive end and they have a negative end. So whenever any stress in the form of tension or compression is applied, there is movement of these bipoles, which leads to generation of the electricity, and that is the reason behind the generation of the piezoelectric concept. Okay. So to study, there are two types of piezoelectric effects. One is a direct effect, that is when we apply the mechanical stress onto these piezoelectric crystals, they undergo deformation due to which a charge is generated or an electric flow is generated, and that flow is called piezoelectricity. Okay. Such kind of effects is seen in power generating sidewalks, where you have the piezoelectric crystals laid below the concrete, and as we move on to these concretes, the crystals undergo deformation and a charge is generated, which is stored in the batteries. These kind of power generating sideways have already been installed in at least 23 European countries by now, and they are doomed to be installed in almost every country in near future. It is also seen in our smartphones, and they are probably one of the next feature that will be there in the smartphone. So we will have these piezoelectric crystals positioned below the screen of the smartphone. As we tap onto the screen or as we work with the phone, the piezoelectric effect will come into play and the charge would be generated, so that the mobile can be recharged through working on mobile, and we don't have to connect it to charger anymore. Okay, but this is not of our use. The effect that we need to study is the inverse piezo effect or the reverse piezo effect. In this, when we apply an electric field onto a piezoelectric material, these piezoelectric materials undergo deformation or physical deformation in the form of strain. Okay, so when these crystals are deformated, a mechanical force is generated, and then this mechanical force is used in the instruments to carry out the necessary output. Okay. So the two type of piezoelectric instruments that we commonly see is the scalar and the piezo surgery unit. Okay. So both of them work on the inverse piezoelectric effect, where an electric field is applied onto the piezoelectric crystals, and because of the electric field, a mechanical force is generated, which is transferred to the tip of the instrument in the form of vibrations. Okay. But there is a huge difference in the type of vibration that is transferred to these instruments. So there are two modes of inverse piezo effect. One is the neutron mode and one is the piezotome mode. Why we need to know this in brief is, Very routinely I face a question that why can't we use the scalar as a piezo surgery unit and why cannot I use a piezo surgery unit as a scalar when both works on the same principle. So in the neutron mode, it's a piezo sinusoidal signal. That means all the waves are in their peak frequencies and you get a same kind of output every time without any break in between. Whereas in a pedotome mode, piezotome mode, it's a modulated wave where you have high peaks and you have low peaks, and these are important for cutting efficiency. I'll explain that in a short while how. So in the neutron mode, you have a constant amplitude of signal which varies when charging power range. So we must have noticed that as we increase the power of our scalar, the vibration speed increases and the power of vibration increases. So it's not just the frequency that is increasing, it's also the amplitude which increase by increasing the electric field onto the scalar. Okay. But same effect is not seen in a piezo surgery unit. Here we have a modulated wave or the modulation principle. So what it do is it uses only the power peak values. So whenever a electric signal is coming in and the crystal is undergoing mechanical deformation, it only uses the waves which are there in their maximum amplitude, and it skips the waves which are there in a lesser amplitude. Okay. Now what happens because of this is that you have a gap interval between a high frequency wave and another high frequency wave. Okay. So this gap or the lower power waves are effective in providing relaxation to the bony tissues. Okay. So if we have to cut a crystal and we apply some force on the crystal, if we do not give time for the crystal to relax, the cutting will not be very efficient. Okay. It's like pushing an object with a knife, and if there is nothing to resist that pushing, or that object does not come towards the knife, it just keeps on going away from the knife by the pressure of the knife will not cut that object. Okay. So what this relaxation do is, it allows the crystal to come back towards the cutting instrument, and then the cutting is carried out very efficiently. Okay. So without going into further physics, all we need to understand is that we are using a modulated principle in the piezo surgery unit, and we are using a neutron mode in the scalars, ultrasonic scalars. So we cannot use the two instruments interchangeably. Okay. Now, as I said, we will be skipping between physics and biology. So coming back to biology, I'll speak briefly on management of pneumatized sinus, then I would again go back to the piezo surgery unit. So before we go ahead with the lateral sinus approach, let me first briefly talk about the anatomy of the maxillary sinus and why we have to do the procedure in this particular way out. Okay. So we know that maxillary sinuses are the biggest sinuses in our body, along apart from the other three groups. The maxillary sinus is usually a pyramidal shaped sinus with its base towards the orbit and its apex towards the alveolar process. Okay. The area of our concern is the lateral wall of the sinus, which is the easily accessible wall for entry into the maxillary sinus. And the two walls that we need to be careful about is the medial wall, which is the nasal wall, and the superior wall, which is the orbital wall. Okay. The nasal wall is a cribriform plate, and we know that cribriform plates are very thin mesh-like structures. So if during elevation of the sinus membrane, we reach up to this cribriform plate and we apply too much of pressure onto the cribriform plate, then there is a possibility that we can break this wall and enter into the nasal cavity. As far as orbital wall is concerned, doing a direct sinus lift for implantology procedure, you have to be really courageous to reach up to this level. Okay. The orbital wall is of a concern usually in cases of accidents and trauma, when there is a fracture of the lower border of the orbit and there is seepage of the orbital muscle content into the maxillary sinus. Okay. So I'm not going to speak much about the superior wall because this is not of our not much concern. All we need to know about is the lateral wall, briefly about the medial wall, and of course the floor, because this is the area which will be the focus of elevation of the maxillary sinus. So we know from our oral surgery and our medicine lectures that the pneumatization of a sinus is an ongoing process which happens with age, and this process could be speeden up due to the loss of the tooth structure. If a tooth is lost at an early age or during midlife period, the pneumatization process can be accelerated. The sinus can dip into the particular area where the tooth is missing. The lesser common reasons for pneumatization of sinus are the pathologies that are developing into the sinus in the form of polyps or chronic sinusitis or cancers or fungi sinusitis. And I would say that if the cause of pneumatization of sinus is the pathology developing in the sinus, then it is beyond the scope of a normal dental surgeon to manage the cases like that. Okay. So the most common cause, I would say, is the loss of tooth and the aging process. Okay. Now, as the pneumatization takes place, Carl Misch has given a classification for the maxillary sinus into four categories. And he has divided this based on the amount of bone remaining between the lower border of the sinus or the floor of the sinus and the ridge of the and the crest of the maxillary ridge. Okay, so an SA1 category is one in which you have more than 10 mm of bone available, so that you can put an at least 10 mm of implant inside. Okay. In this case, you do not have to do anything for the sinus. You can just go ahead with your routine implantology. SA2 is a situation in which you have more than 6 millimeters but less than 10 millimeters of bone available. So these cases can be easily managed through an indirect sinus lift, and you don't have to open up the entire sinus to gain some bone volume. Okay. But in cases where the pneumatization is quite severe, the cases like SA3 and SA4. So in SA3, you have less than 6 mm of bone available but more than 3 mm of bone. Now, why more than 3 and less than 6? If it's less than 6, then you cannot, ideally, you cannot do an indirect sinus lift, although there are procedures which claim that you can do an indirect sinus lift even in residual bone volume of 3 millimeters. But I don't believe in those philosophies. I never do an indirect sinus lift of more than 4 millimeters. So, if you have bone available less than 6 but more than 3, then you can do a direct sinus lift as well as simultaneous implant placement. Now, this minimum availability of 3 mm of alveolar bone is necessary to provide the initial stability of the implant. So that's why you can have a one stage procedure where you can do the sinus lift as well as implant in the same sitting. Okay. In the category SA4, the residual bone volume is less than 3 millimeters. So you cannot do a simultaneous implant placement in these situations. You have to do a two stage procedure where you do a direct sinus lift in the first surgery, and then you open up again to do the implant insertions. Okay, so the area of concern for today's lecture would be the SA3 and the SA4 categories, and these are the areas which will go for direct sinus lift. Okay. So there are various methods to manage the pneumatized sinus. Of course, the indirect or the crestal approach sinus lift, as I said, is recommended in SA2 categories, and the direct and the lateral approach sinus lift is recommended in SA3 and SA4 categories. And of course, the third option is to avoid the sinus by either going with an all-on-4 approach by placing tilting implants, maybe an all-on-6 by placing implants even distal to the sinus, or you can go ahead with the pterygoid implants and zygomatic implants if you are proficient in that. But I usually avoid those areas because, one, it's a complex anatomy structure. I'm a prosthodontist, I'm not a surgeon, so it's beyond my scope to explore those areas. And thirdly, if we involve pterygoid as an implant, then restoring up to 8, I don't think it's biomechanically feasible, and it's not biomechanically recommended also to restore as back as up to 7 and 8. Okay. So coming on to the direct sinus lift procedure, what is the direct sinus lift procedure? So it is elevating the sinus floor through the lateral window. This lateral window is made distal to the canine eminence, and the procedure is called a modified Calvert look approach. We have all studied the Calvert look approach in our surgery lectures, where we make a window distal to the canine eminence in the canine fossa, and we curate out all the contents of the sinus to relieve the patient from chronic sinusitis or some foreign body inclusion. Okay. But what we do in a modified Calvert look approach is we do make a window similar to the Calvert look, but we preserve the sinus membrane because we want to put the graft between the sinus membrane and the alveolar bone. Okay. So for direct sinus lift, there are three key elements which we need to consider before going ahead with the surgery. Okay. Of course, the first and the foremost is the lateral window opening. Where should be the window? How big should be the window? And how we have to make this window. Okay. The second consideration that we need to consider about is the membrane elevation. If we don't take care of the membrane, then the entire procedure can go haywire, and we can develop complications far worse than what we anticipate. And of course, grafting of the sinus. What kind of graft we have to place, how much of graft we have to place, and what combination, what material, what particle size, and how long shall we wait for the graft to integrate. Okay. Again, discussing everything is beyond the scope of a single webinar. So I will be focusing mainly on the lateral window opening and briefly on membrane elevation. Grafting the sinus is a separate lecture topic in itself. Okay. So coming on to the lateral window opening, the classical method or the age-old method is a postage stamp method with round burr, where you make multiple points using the round burr and then you join them. Or you can use specialized kits available from some implant manufacturers, like the LAS kit, which is available from Austin, and the TOLA kit, which is available from, I think, Surgident. Okay. Okay. Guys, I think I need to hold on for a second. There is okay, everything is all right. Okay, somebody fell down in our office. They are fine now. Okay. And the third, of course, and the most easiest and the smoothest way to go about is the piezo surgery for opening the lateral window. Okay, so if we see the first method, lateral opening with the round burr, you can see the amount of bone that is lost around the window is more than the amount of bone remaining in the window. One. Second, we know that with rotating instruments, high-speed rotating instruments, we can have the soft tissues of the flap getting entangled there. And if we are not very trained, we do not have the right tactile sense, and we are not very careful, we can even damage the membrane permanently. Okay. So postage stamp method is the method used. We need to see the blue hue of the membrane. As soon as we can see the blue hue of the membrane, we have to be very careful that we do not drill more. Okay. Blood coming out from the microvessels which are there between the bone and the Schneiderian membrane can be an indicator that, okay, we have perforated the bone now, we are at the membrane level, we should not go more deep. But doing this with a piezo surgery is far more convenient. You can get very precise cuts, you can see the precision of the cuts, it's very nicely, very neat procedure. You get very smooth edges, you don't have to smoothen the edges later on. And there is a negligible chance of membrane perforation because these piezo surgery instruments do not cut soft tissues. Okay. Okay. So it's lesser traumatic both for the clinician as well as the patient. If we do not have to be very cautious on looking at the membrane, being wary that we do not touch the membrane or we do not break it, we do not perforate it, we can perform the surgery much better. We can concentrate on the window and not on the membrane. And we can finish this procedure much faster. Okay. Just to share with you, both the cases are mine. If I have to make this window, it takes me about 40 minutes, 40, 45 minutes to make this window, whereas I can make this window in less than 5 minutes. And of course, healing is a big factor with piezo surgery. We will come to this a little later on. That how the microvasculature is stimulated because of the piezo waves, and a faster healing can be done. Okay. Coming on to the clinical considerations of the direct sinus lift procedure, the first one is the dimension of the window. Okay. How big should be the window, and the location of the window, where should the window start from and where should it end from? So the dimension of the window would depend on the edentulous, on the span of the edentulous area. If I'm doing the direct sinus lift for a single implant for a missing first molar, my window would be of about 10 by 10 millimeter. Whereas if I'm doing a sinus lift, direct sinus lift for an edentulous patient, completely edentulous patient, or all the posteriors missing, my window can be as big as 25 by 25 millimeters. Okay. So you need to assess that how big an area you need to graft, Your sinus curettes should be accessible to the areas where you want to concentrate your grafts to, and you should decide the dimensions of the window accordingly. Okay. It is okay to make a wider window rather than making a smaller window, because if you end up with a smaller window and your sinus curettes are not going into the sinus, to increase the size of the window would be an issue there. Okay. The location of the window, again, this is very critical. When we are making the lateral window into the sinus, it is important that all the walls or all the edges of the window are within the sinus, because if any of the wall is not into the sinus, the window will not be separated from the bone. Okay. So the recommendation is that the inferior most cut or the lower most cut should be placed at least 2 millimeter higher than the floor of the sinus. And the superior most, again, it depends on the dimension that you are looking at. If you have tooth mesial or distal to the window, then the mesial and distal cuts should be positioned behind or in front of the root and prominence. And if you do not have any tooth, then again, it depends that how big a window you want to make. But the critical thing is the lower part of the window, the lower border of the window, it should be positioned at least 2 mm apical to the floor of the sinus. Then the decision to infracture the window or the outfracture the window. Okay. When I started doing my direct sinus lift procedures, I always used to infracture the window because I was scared to peel off the bony part from the membrane, thinking that the membrane can be attached to the bony piece and it can tear along with the bony part. Okay. And I was not wrong in doing that, because I started doing my sinus lift procedures with the round burr and the postage stamp methods, where the edges used to be very ragged and the membrane used to adhere in a lot of places. Okay. But the advantage of doing an infracture is that when you infracture the bony wall, that bony wall can become the new floor of the sinus, and you can pack the graft below it, you can nicely compact it. Okay. But as I moved in my implant practice, or I should say as I moved ahead in my direct sinus lift practice, I gained more and more experience in doing these procedures, and I started using piezo surgery. I started out fracturing my window. Okay. The advantage of out fracturing the window is we have a clear view of the sinus. Even if there is a micro perforation, because of the window making procedure, we can see those micro perforations and we can repair those micro perforations. And also the out fractured bony piece can be used to close the bony window, and we don't have to use any membranes or autogenous bone grafts or titanium tacks later on to secure the lateral defect in the bone. The fourth thing that we need to assess is the arterial anastomosis. We know that in the lateral wall of the maxillary sinus, there is an arterial anastomosis of the posterior superior alveolar artery and the nasopalatine artery. So to see this arterial anastomosis, it is prudent that we get a conventional CT done or a micro CT done, because if you do a CVCT, the differentiation between the soft tissue and the hard tissue is not very very conspicuous. There is a possibility that there might be an arterial anastomosis, and it is not clearly visible in the CBCT. Okay. Also, the field of CBCT machines usually is very narrow, or they are focused to a particular area, and you do not get so much of area recorded in the CT to see the entire extent of the sinus. Okay. So the best is you get a micro CT done, and then you move around in the axial slices and you look for this anastomosis. Now, the problem with this anastomosis is that this anastomosis is present within the bone. It is not present on the inside or the outside of the bone. So, if during the procedure of making the lateral window, you hit onto this anastomosis, there would be a bleed, a significant bleed, and that bleed would be an intraosseous bleed. So, it will be very difficult to apply pressure onto this anastomosis to identify where the bleed is coming from and then to stop the bleed. The two areas where you can most commonly hit onto this anastomosis, one is if you are doing the direct sinus lift in a very young patient, because we know that arterial anastomosis keeps on decreasing in size as the age advances, And the second area would be if there is excessive bone loss. The alveolar bone loss is quite a lot because the arterial anastomosis is present on a slightly higher level. Okay. The fifth thing that you need to assess is whether you have to make one window or two window. Again, this would depend on two factors. One is one window is when I'm doing a small sinus lift procedure. Two window is when I'm doing a bigger sinus lift, or I'm accessing three or four posterior missing teeth, and if in case there is a septa present in the maxillary sinus. I will show you a case of two windows where I have a septa present in the maxillary sinus, why we opted for two windows in those cases. Okay. So before going ahead with the sinus lift procedure itself, we need to understand the tips that are available with the piezo surgery units. Because it is critical that we use the right tip to make the window. Okay. So we have piezo surgery tips in three varieties. One is the cutting, second is smoothening, and third is non-cutting. So the cutting teeth, they have teeth-like projections. So they can also be called as saw or bone saw. Okay. Now these are to be used when you need gross bony cutting and you're not working in proximity to soft tissues, because the soft tissues can get damaged because of the pointed ends of the tooth projections. Okay? Not because of the piezo surgery movements, but because of the tooth-like projections. Okay? The second type of tip is the smoothening tip. They are the diamond-coated tips or the center diamonds. It's just like our diamond points or the center diamond drills that are used in the labs and other milling machines. So they work on abrasion principles. They abrade the bone and they don't cut the bone. And these are the tips to be used to make the bony windows for the sinus lift procedure. Okay. The third type of tips are the non-cutting tips. They are the smooth tips, and these are the tips used to elevate the sinus membrane and to release it from the bony walls. Okay. So a small video where we start with the diamond coated tips. We start marking the boundaries of the sinus lift window. You can see because of the cavitation effect or the coolant flow, it's a very neat and clean field. All you need to do is just to use a normal suction and a normal retraction. The field is very clear. It's a very smooth procedure. You don't have to go slow. You can go at a very fast pace because these tips will not cut the sinus membrane. Even if you touch the membrane, it will not cut. Compare this to a round bar in an air rotor or a micromotor handpiece, you would have to go much slower. Okay. So you go all around. Okay. Here the surgeon is going to infracture the window, that's why they are making a wider cut. I usually outfracture the window, so I make much finer cuts so that the window can be positioned precisely back. Okay. So you can see the window is totally loose, it's been detached from all the sides. Now you can smoothen out the ragged edges of the window. Okay. You just slightly push it in. Okay. You can see the movement of the window with the breathing of the patient. Okay. And you can see the blood coming out from the microcapillaries between the membrane and the bone. Okay. As long as this blood is coming out, you are safe. Because if the membrane would have perforated, this blood would go into the sinus. Okay. Okay. Pushing the membrane slightly away, we smoothen the ragged edges, because we know if the edges are ragged, the membrane can be attached in these areas and it can get torn off at the time of peeling. So we need to just smoothen this off. Once all the edges are smoothened up, we take smooth tips and then we start going all around the sinus. We always start with the floor of the sinus first, because that is the key area of focus and that is easiest to detach. Okay, so you can see that till now the surgeon has not used any sinus curette. They are doing the entire procedure using the piezo surgery instrument. So because of the micro vibrations, the membrane is getting moved away from the wall, bony wall, and since they are using soft tips, there is no danger of tearing the membrane or cutting into the membrane. Okay, so once the lift is significant, you can go ahead packing your graft. Okay, we will not discuss the grafting material today because, as I have already said, it's a separate lecture topic. Okay, coming on to the advantages of using piezo surgery, not only for the sinus lift procedure but for any surgical procedure. But I will give examples from the sinus lift procedure itself. Okay, the biggest advantage is the selective cutting. It cuts only the hard tissues. It spares the soft tissues. Okay, and this is a boon in case of a direct sinus lift procedure. We know that there is a very thin Schneiderian membrane. We have to preserve that membrane, so we do not cut that membrane. Okay, of course, it's not just the sinus membrane, but also the blood vessels, the nerves, and the mucosas. They are also safe. So even if the anastomoses come in line, the arterial anastomoses that we were discussing earlier, even if it comes line of the bony window, there's a huge possibility that it will not bleed because the vessels will not be cut. Okay. Second is you get clean and precise micrometric osteotomy cut, because with piezo surgery units there is no run out and there is no loss of concentricity, so the cuts are very, very precise compared to a rotary instrument where the cuts are very ragged and the amount of bone loss is also huge. Okay, so there is no imperfections, there is no pigmentation or scarring or no cellular scarring, because of which the healing is very smooth. Patient do not feel any macro vibrations. The patients are also very relaxed and the surgeons are also very relaxed during the procedure. The third advantage, that is the cavitation effect. Okay. So because of the cavitation effect, you can maintain a clean surgical site with higher visibility. Okay. Now what is the cavitation effect is, as this tip of piezo surgery unit is vibrating at a very high speed, the coolant is focused onto this tip, because of which it is burst into millions of smaller particles which can go way deeper into the tissue and bring about the coolant effect. So it's not just the cooling, but it also maintains a very clear surgical site. Okay. So there are three effects of the cavitation principle. The first is cavitation disperses coolant fluid as an aerosol that causes the blood to essentially be washed away, because of which you get a clean feel. But it also brings about hemostasis, which results in bloodless surgeries. You must have seen in the video of sinus lift that the amount of blood that was coming out was very, very less, and the isolation and visibility was excellent. But Vamsley et al. Have also recommended it that there is an antibacterial efficiency of piezo surgery procedures because of the cavitation effect, that it fragments the cellular wall. Okay, so consider this as a cellular wall. So once the particles of the coolant are bombarded on it with a lot of force, they go through the cellular wall of the bacteria and it can be ruptured and killed. The effective cooling is not only because of the cavitation effect, but along with the cavitation effect, the oscillating tip pushes the fluid way deep into the tissues. Okay, so you might be using coolants, or you might be using internally cooled handpieces, internally cooled drills with your rotary instruments, but that cooling would be far more inferior than the cooling effect achieved with these piezo surgery units, because the coolant is pushed much deeper into the tissue. Okay, and we know that as the temperature exceeds 47 degrees, the bone necrosis or the cellular apoptosis starts to happen. Okay, the fifth advantage of piezo surgery is the pressure. Okay, so with experience you would realize that with piezo surgery units you have to use very minimal pressure.
Another question, technically audio change.
With piezo surgery, sorry for the interruption. So with piezo surgery units, you have to use very minimal pressure. The optimal load is 150 grams, which is about 6 times the force used during periodontal probing. Okay. So what happens is, when you use a controlled amount of force with your instrument, you don't damage onto the tissues which are just ahead of the area that you're working on. Okay. The chances of slippage of the instrument is very less, and the chances of the rotating instruments going deeper into the tissues is decreased a lot, and also the operator fatigue is decreased a lot because of the limited pressure that is required to work with these instruments. I'm just going to show you one case, because this case is sufficient to speak volumes of advantages of using piezo surgery. I can show you cases on each and every aspect of oral maxillofacial surgery where we need to cut bone using piezo surgery. But since today we are working on direct sinus lift, I will show you only the direct sinus lift case. Okay. So this was the patient where we had to replace the premolars and the molars, and the residual bone thickness was about 4 to 5 millimeters. You can see the markings here, it's about 4 to 5 millimeters. Okay. And I cannot get the cross sections right. There was a septa here in the sinus. Okay. Yeah, can you see here? There is a septae in the sinus, okay, in this particular area. Now because of the septae, I had to make two windows, one mesial to the septa and one distal to the septa. And also the edentulous span was long, okay, because of which we had to put three implants, and we needed the sinus lifts in all these three regions. Okay. So we started making precise cuts. You can see the precision of the cuts. You can see how neat and clean that window is. So there's a one window here, there's one window there. Okay, I can even work in such distally inaccessible areas with piezo surgery units, because even if my flap touches my piezo surgery instrument, I am not bothered. It's not gonna cut the flap. Whereas if I would have been using a rotating instrument, I would have to reflect much, much more. I have to stretch this flap a lot, and I have to strain myself a lot to keep this flap in a higher position. Okay. Then the three implants were put in. The sinus were grafted nicely. But the most amazing part is the bony pieces that were out fractured, they were positioned back precisely. I don't need any stabilization membrane or tacks or screws or pins to hold this bony window into position. Okay. All I did was I just placed these bony pieces back and close the flap on top. Okay. Now it is critical to close these sinus approaches, because if I don't get it right, there could be a dehiscence from this area where all my graft can get washed away. Again, that would be a smaller concern, because that can be redone. But the bigger concern is the sinus can get affected through these openings if they are not closed properly with the bone formation. Okay. So without fracturing of the bone, such precise cuts, it saves a lot of time for me, and it saves a lot of money. I can spend that much of money on the graft material rather than on membranes and tacks. And I can do much, much, many, many more patients if I do it this way. Okay. Another reason for doing this is you can see there is an immediate molar extraction site, and with an immediate site, the primary closure is never 100%. So we might have some opening from here, and if I leave the sinus membrane open from here, the infection can creep in, or the graft can creep out, and a lot of harmful things can happen. So this is possible only by use of piezo surgery. The equipment used here was the Woodpecker 60 watt piezo surgery. I always prefer a 60 watt surgery, because I also use these equipments for harder bones, in case of thin mandibular ridges where I have to do ridge splits. These windows can be made with a 30 watt piezo or a 25 watt piezo as well. But if we have to trim the bone around the third molar, or we have to do a ridge splitting in case of a thin ridge, we need a 60 watt unit for sure. Coming on to the benefits of the direct sinus lift procedure. Okay. This is an open procedure. You can see the entire sinus. If you perforate the membrane, you can repair it. If you find some foreign material or pathology, you can remove it. You can do whatever you want to do if you have an open procedure. Okay. There have been an incidences where I've been doing an indirect sinus lift, which is a closed procedure. and I perforated the membrane accidentally without knowing that the membrane is perforated, and when I started putting my implant in, my membrane implant slipped into the sinus. Now, since it was a closed procedure, I did not have the option of retrieving the implant. I had to schedule the patient for a second surgery where I had to make a lateral window and then retrieve the implant. Whereas with direct sinus lift procedure, it's an open procedure. You see everything. If anything is going wrong, you can manage it then and there. I've already said perforations can be easily visualized and easily repaired. Sinus membrane can be elevated to any degree. Okay, you can do a sinus lift, direct sinus lift procedure and place an implant of 30 millimeters. Although I don't do it personally, let's not discuss this here because again it's a part of the grafting procedure. But you can lift the sinus to 15 millimeters, 20 millimeters, 25 millimeters. How much you want is totally at your convenience. Only thing that you need to keep in mind that the opening of the maxillary sinus at the infundibulum should not be blocked. And it's a more predictable procedure because you can see everything with the naked eye as it is going on, and you can control what is going on. Okay. The limitations of the direct sinus lift: it's a moderately extensive surgical procedure. You need to have some skills of some surgical skills developed before you go ahead with these procedures. You need to have some specialized equipment. There is a larger learning curve in opening the lateral window than the indirect sinus lift. The chances of dehiscence of the lateral window is always there, but as I said, if I'm using a piezo surgery and I'm repositioning the bony fragment back, these chances are brought down a lot. There is a greater risk of sinus infection because we are opening the sinus to a larger extent, we are manipulating it to a larger extent, so we need to be very careful with our sterilization protocols. Fumigating the operatory is a must, it's mandatory before you do a direct sinus lift. And of course, the usual autoclaving procedure and the universal infection control protocols to be followed. Okay. Frequent post-op difficulties in the form of nasal bleeds, a lot of swelling, edema developing, patient complaining of some amount of pain, some graft particles oozing out from the nose in case of microperforations. So you have those post-op difficulties, but they are not major, nothing major that cannot be managed. If you know and you can warn the patient beforehand, it's okay, it's totally okay to be managed. Okay. Some of the complications that can occur at the time of sinus lift procedure, which you need to be careful of, and you should be adapted enough to manage them if it happens. So intraoperative complications in the form of membrane perforations. Again, if you do it with piezo surgery, the rate of these complications developing would be much, much lower compared to a rotary instrument. Intral septa, I have already told you, if you incorporate an intral septa, if you come across an intral septa, then how you can manage it. I usually prefer making a window anterior to the septa and a window distal to the septa, and then using that intral septa to stabilize my implant. Okay. Third is, of course, bleeding. Again, if you study the anatomy carefully, you get the right CT done, you carefully view the anastomosis, and you use the milder instruments in the form of piezo surgery, the bleeding rate would be much lower. Okay. Polyps and cysts, frankly speaking, till now I have not come across with any polyp or cysts that are there in the sinus, but if you get the CT done and you find out that there is a polyp or a cyst in the sinus, you need to be careful. Take help of your oral and maxillofacial surgeon or an ENT surgeon if the size of the cyst and polyp is a bigger one, so that it can be removed at the same surgery itself. Okay. Post-operative complications in the form of incision line opening. Okay. The incision line opening usually takes place because of the post-operative edema. So when the tissues are stretched a lot, the sutures can give away and the incision line can open up. Again, with piezo surgery, the amount of edema that will develop would be much lower than the rotating instrument. So, this complication developing also would be much lower. Okay. Nerve impairment, again, if you are doing it with a rotary instrument and you touch any of the nerve, we know that the posterior superior nerve also runs along the lateral wall of the sinus between the Schneiderian membrane and the bony wall. So, if you are doing using a rotary instrument and you accidentally touch onto the nerve, there is a chance that a transient paresthesia or hyperesthesia can develop. But again, using with the piezo surgery, we know that it does not cut soft tissue. These complications are again much lower. Acute rhinosinusitis, this will develop in almost 60 to 70% of the cases, because as we manipulate the membrane, some inflammation inside the sinus is bound to happen, and that will manifest in the form of acute rhinosinusitis. We need to just cautious the patient that he should not sneeze or blow too vigorously, because that would lead to movements of the graft inside. And maybe we can put the patient on some antihistaminics for short duration in the form of cetirizine or levocetirizine, maybe for 2 weeks. That should take care of everything. Implant penetration into the sinus, again, this this is more an occurrence with an indirect procedure than a direct occurrence, than a direct sinus lift, because in a direct sinus lift, we see the implant going into the sinus when we are doing the implant, whereas with an indirect sinus lift, it's a blind procedure. Oroventral fistula, if the flap does not close properly, or there is a dehiscence on the lateral wall of the sinus, or the osteotomy site give away, then there is the oroventral fistula can develop, and we know how to manage that from our oral surgery lectures. Overfilling the sinus, we need to be very careful. We should not overfill the sinus, because as we keep on lifting the membrane, we are going close to the sinus opening in the medial wall of the nose. So if you overfill the sinus, it's possible that the sinus volume is decreased a lot. It will not be able to do the physiologic function that it was supposed to do, and the contents may not be draining in the right position, which can lead to chronic sinusitis. Okay. Post-operative cyst, again, it's a theoretical complication. I have never met any surgeon who has developed this after the sinus lift procedure. Long-term results with the sinus lift procedures. Okay. Most reports contain high survival rates with sinus grafts as well as implants placed. Okay. There is a 90 to 97% survival rate, and this survival rate is much higher when you compare the grafting procedure in any other site in the entire body. Okay. The reason to that is this is probably the only site where the graft is encapsulated from all the areas, and there is no open wall even on a single site. All grafts and graft combination yield similar results. It does not matter whether you use an autogenous graft, an allograft, alloplast, xenografts. They all yield in good results. Okay. So according to Del Fabro, a study conducted in 2004, they found out that if you're using only autologous bone, the success is about 87%. I would never use only autologous bone, because to fill a sinus with only autogenous bone, I have to harvest a lot of autogenous bone. And the resorption rate of autogenous bone is fastest among all the graft materials, and which is not desirable in a direct sinus lift procedure, or I would say in any grafting procedure. Okay. A 95% success rate when autograft is combined with various bone substitutes. Of course, this combination works the best. Okay. A 96% with bone substitutes only. This shows you there's no much difference between 95 and 96, but this shows you that even if you're not using any autogenous bone, this graft uptake is very, very good in direct sinus lift procedure, because of the simple fact that it is encapsulated from all the sites. Okay. Smooth surface implants, they have a success rate of 86%, whereas rough implants have a success rate of 96%. Again, these figures can be generalized to everywhere. I still believe that rough surface implants are the way to go about. Okay. So to conclude, in the past, implant treatment of posterior maxilla was considered as the least predictable reason for implant survival because of the soft bone quality, and inadequate height was one of the major reasons for it. Okay. But now, with the introduction of sinus lift procedures, treatment of the posterior maxilla has become much more predictable, and sinus grafting has been one of the major reasons for its accomplishment. If a patient comes to me for implant consultation with teeth missing in posterior maxilla, I would not say 100%, but in almost 99.9% of the patients, I say without looking at the patient that I can put a graft there. I can put an implant there, sorry. Whereas if a patient comes to me with missing mandibular teeth, I would be skeptical making such statement before seeing the patient, before going ahead with the x-rays and the sinus lifts. So the predictability of the grafting is so high that I almost always commit the patient that yes, I can do an implant in posterior maxilla without even looking the CT scans and the x-rays. The procedure experiences high rate of success, and this region grows more bone in height than any other intraoral region. I have already quoted studies regarding this. With the introduction of piezo surgery equipments, direct sinus lift, which was once considered an advanced implantology procedure, can now be considered a routine implantology procedure. An individual like me, who's not a trained surgeon, who's not a born surgeon, I am a practiced surgeon, or I can say I'm a hard-working surgeon. I'm still developing my surgical skills. I used to be very scared of doing sinus lift procedures using rotating instruments or diamond burrs or carbide burrs. But with piezo surgery, it's a routine procedure in my clinic. The complications associated with lateral approach are minimized to a greater degree using piezo surgery. It's not only the treatment time, but also the healing phase that is reduced drastically using piezo surgery. And this is probably the reason why I've started doing more sinus lifts. And to all my colleagues who have started using piezo surgery, they also have said that those cases which we were trying to do with indirect sinus lifts earlier, now we try and do it with direct sinus lift because that's a much safer and a much neater approach, especially with the use of piezo surgery units. I know all of you know this guy. I hope all of you know this guy, Dr. Oscom Hiltatum. He is considered father of sinus grafting. So he once said that if you ask me where would I like to put my graft, I would choose maxillary sinus each and every time. Okay. And this statement comes as a follow-up from me. If you ask me how I would like to enter a maxillary sinus, I would choose piezo surgery each and every time. Thank you for your patient listening. We have finished with still 5 minutes left in the hour, and I'm open up to take some questions. So if you have any question, you can type in the chat window and I can read it then and I will answer it. Okay, I have a question from Dr. Aditya where he says comparison between lasers and piezo. Sir, I would never use a laser to do my to the lateral sinus lift window, because even if I'm using a hard tissue laser, the lasers can still damage the sinus membrane, and it will damage the sinus membrane. Contraindication of lateral window approach, I would say a lot of sinus pathology, that is a contraindication to the sinus lift procedure as such. But there is no contraindication to a lateral window approach. Of course, the contraindications that are there for implant procedure or any surgical procedure also apply to the lateral sinus approach. Cost of the piezo, okay, that's a good question. I would say that I'm not a salesperson, but I would still give you a rough approximate. Dr. Smriti can give you the cost exactly, but I would briefly mention here that we'll type it here for you. The Woodpecker 60 watt piezo is about 1,60,000. Inclusive of taxes, and it comes with two hand pieces and 14 tips. That is one unit which I have. If you go ahead with NSK, it's about 3 lakhs, and if you go with Cetalac, it's about 3.5 lakhs. But then this is an equipment which is not used every day. This is used once or twice a week, and sometimes twice or thrice a month. So I would not spend so much of money going for NSK and Cetalac. Woodpecker works fine for me. Patient treatment cost, sir, piezo surgery is for my convenience. If I can do the procedure much faster, much neatly, why should I charge more for the patient? Okay. Of course, the patient will heal up much better. So they will definitely appreciate your work and bring you more patients in. And because of that, they will pay you more indirectly. Dr. Ajit, I think I've already explained the cost of the equipment. Is there any other cost that you want to ask about? Okay, Dr. Smriti just told me that you can even buy this instrument on EMI. Although she sold me this on a flat payment, I never had an option of EMI available. Cost of surgery, sir, it depends. See, there is no cost involved from the piezo surgery equipment point of view because I have been using my initial piezo surgery tips still now, and I would have done at least 40 surgeries by now. None of the tip have upgraded. Even if you need to change a tip, it is about 4 to 5 thousand rupees a tip, and it works for again 30-40 surgeries easily. The cost of the graft, it depends on what graft you are using. The most expensive being the bovine. So I always use a mixture of beta TCP and bovine, and grafting of one sinus approximately costs me about 12-13 thousand rupees. Management of the septa, ma'am, we cannot do much about the septa. The best is to avoid the septa in the window formation. Make a window mesial to the septa, make a window distal to the septa if you have to put implants on either side of the septae. And usually the septae are hard tissues, so you can position your implant in the septa and use it for anchorage. Dr. Avnish, bone grafting material. Best grafting material is a combination of xeno and alloplast. If you can harvest autogenous and mix, there's nothing better than that. But again, I avoid doing it because the success is almost similar with all the materials. Dr. Aditya, you're asking about the training of the equipment. I guess there is a course scheduled of Dr. Dhruv Arora on 24th of September. He is a very close friend of mine and a very expert surgeon on piezo surgery. We will send you the details of these courses. Dr. Smriti will take care of that. You can go and see it live on the patients, and you can work on the models as well using the piezo surgery equipment, and then you can go ahead from there. Dr. Harish, the same applies to you as well. You can join this 24th September course where you can see the working of piezo surgery on the patients and also on the, and then you can and then you can do hands-on on models. And one more thing, Dr. Harish, that I would like to say, you have said that I am only a BDS. I feel that BDS itself is a specialty because we are already specialists in oral cavity. By doing MDS, we only learn more about a specific field. We do not become a specialist by doing MDS. So even if you are a BDS, I have seen a lot of BDS friends of mine and I've seen a lot of BDS seniors from me who do much better procedures than I do. Dr. Aditya, we do have a recorded, we have definitely recorded this session. This will be available in 2 or 3 days on the Unicorn Denmark portal. On YouTube channel, Unicorn Denmark YouTube channel, sorry. Okay, so if there is no more questions, then we can end the session. Thanks a lot, guys, for your patient listening. You have been a wonderful audience. I look forward to join with you in future webinars. Thanks a lot.